Trails Along the Road on BCTV is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. Welcome to Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. I'm Kendra Cook. The Boyertown Museum is open 7 days a week from 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. And we are located at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, Pennsylvania. If you'd like to get a hold of us there, you can give us a call, 610-367-2090, or you can visit our website, www.boyertownmuseum.org, or send us an email, mail, at boyertownmuseum.org. And the museum has a little bit of something for everybody, so we hope you will take an opportunity to visit us if you haven't already. If you have, come and see something new. We're always changing the stuff around, and we've got dozens of carriages and trucks, cars, bicycles on display, and our carriage factory, which is an 1872 building, it's really where vehicle building began in Boyertown, is open on Saturdays from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., and during that time, we do have blacksmithing demonstrations going on up in the carriage factory. So it's really neat. It's popular. It's included with your regular admission. So it's like an extra perk for those of you that are visiting on Saturdays. And the blacksmithing is great. We hope you join us for one of those. If not, Dan's favorite event is coming up. Pretty soon, actually.
Oh, Diner Day.
Yeah. Yeah. And the next Diner Day is Saturday, November 5th. It's from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. And it's in our beautiful 1938 Reading Diner, which used to be part of Fagley's Family Restaurant. So come on November 5th, and you will pay your normal admission. But then you can go in the diner, and you can get pie and coffee really cheap, like a quarter for
like
your
really,
pie.
Really
like
cheap.
Really cheap.
But the pie itself is not cheap.
No, it's quality. Very good. And I heard today that we are for sure going to have some pumpkin, some coconut cream, and some peanut butter pies on hand for November 5th. So we've already got some of the flavors lined up.
November 5th.
Yeah, write it down. Dan, I expect to see you there. so that's really what I have for the museum, except that we did just have our 51st annual Duryea Day this past weekend. We hope that you had a chance to join us at Boyertown Community Park on Saturday. We had, I believe, about 630 vehicles on the field. So, and Dan and I were all over that field on Saturday, and there was a lot of cool stuff.
Nice.
So hopefully we're able to make it this year. If not, there's always next year. And hopefully the weather will be as good next year as it was Saturday. It was perfect. So with that, we're going to get on with our show this evening. And a reminder that the show is live on the first Tuesday of every month at 9 p.m. So if you're watching the first Tuesday, please take down this phone number. It's 610-378-0426. That's the number for the studio. You'll especially want that when we get to the car quiz at the end of the program. So we'll give it to you again before we get to the car quiz. But before we do that, I'll introduce, of course, our panelists this evening, which you're all going to recognize, I'm sure. Of course, Dan is here, as always.
Hi, folks.
And our regular guest, Sam Fioriani, is here this evening. Thank you, Sam, for joining us.
Thanks. You say our panelists. I almost feel like I'm on to tell the truth.
Yeah, right.
You
know? I am Dan Olsen.
Yeah.
Okay. We could do that some night. We'll have to think of something.
We could.
All right.
We could.
I'll wear the extra Dan Olsen name tag we have at the museum.
We're all wear plaid
yeah.
shirts.
Yeah. They'll never be able to identify which is the real Dan Olsen yeah. if I do that. So we're going to kind of do, we did this a couple months ago where we kind of talked mm-hmm. about some upcoming car technology. I believe we did fuel injection last time.
Right.
So we're going to pick a different topic here. So Dan, what's our...
Yes, it was like, I think 4 months ago, Sam was on mm-hmm. and we talked about, I guess, introducing fuel to an engine because we right. talked about injection and carburation and all that stuff. And Sam and I kind of worked together on this a little bit, and what we're going to be talking about is materials that are in cars today. But Sam did some history or some research on the history of that, and why don't you take it away?
Well, we're talking about materials for cars and what we would put in the different components for the car. I went back to start on the bodywork, because cars originally were extension of the carriages, mm-hmm. as you said. They, mm-hmm. So the carriages were originally mostly wood and other relatively simple materials to work with, mm-hmm. Iron and such. And if you pull up the first slide there, the original cars were high-wheeled versions of carriages. Mm-hmm. So this is a 1907 Success Model B, and you can see that the spokes are wood. The most of the bodywork is wood, and there's some fabric work in the bodywork, but there's no steel in the body. Mm-hmm. It's very, very simple. This is a Model T body, and you can see the actual wood in the body. When you watch a car being restored, you see all the wood that's used in the framing of the body. It's more architecture than automotive engineering in the early cars.
It's a good term, architecture.
Architecture.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, you got to keep the termites out.
You know, I was just reading something over the weekend in an online forum, and somebody was putting together a Model T Ford. And he was complaining about the nails, putting the nails in it, and it kept bending. And he says, am I doing something wrong, or should I use different nails and stuff? And it's something we just don't think of, but as your picture shows, it's a wood frame, and then they put the metal sheets on it, and mm-hmm. they had to connect it somehow.
Right, so. Right. No, the woodwork on these cars is spectacular on a lot of them. This one here is a 1915 Stanley Mountain Wagon. And you can see the five rows of seats in the vehicle mm-hmm. here, but all the bodywork is again wood. Mm-hmm. And as the museum has, they have the Town and Country. And if anyone right. goes to the museum to take a look at that it'll show you just how amazing the woodwork is on these cars. If you look at that, it's like cabinetry on that car.
Absolutely. Yeah.
The dovetailing
Absolutely.
Of the wood on the yep. back. And this car here is it has a metal frame, but the bodywork is mostly wood.
Mm-hmm. I've also seen some cars, some vehicles back from that era, and this is an outgrowth of the buggies, also the horse-drawn buggies, is they'll have actually patent leather.
Right.
Like the fenders,
right.
sometimes the dash in front of it. In fact, the Success car you had, I was almost wondering if the dash on it, if that was like a leather type material.
Right. No, they did use a lot of mm-hmm. leather and
because it was easy to work with,
right?
It was handy,
and it was literally a dashboard. It was just mm-hmm. to keep the dirt off of the riders,
right.
but because
mm-hmm.
the riders aren't going that fast at that speed
right.
anyway. So,
mm-hmm.
But the wood gave way to woody wagons.
Wow.
So most of the cars by the 30s and 40s were steel, and only in special editions like this woody wagon were they using wood at all. Most wagons were touted for their steel wagon,
mm-hmm.
but you can see this one. This is a Ford wagon, and it's the extensive use of wood in this one. It's just beautiful, and I've been told by a number of people who worked in wood, that you had to treat them more like boats.
Okay.
Because you had to refinish the bodies, sense. Especially like town and countries. You have to refinish those bodies all the time just to keep them going.
Yeah.
And I have a feeling with these, you probably have to take care of it more than you would a boat, because driving a car is a lot more flexing, I think, than a boat would be.
Yeah, no.
There's a lot more joints in this than I think.
Absolutely. Yeah, the creaking you would hear inside of a
creaking
any woody wagon would be.
Yeah. It's not just my bones.
Well, the
I'm not saying a word.
Woody wagons gave way to wood fake wagons.
Yes. Okay.
And this is a sample of a 3M Dynoc, which was used in woody wagons in the 50s and 60s and into the 70s and 80s. As a matter of fact, the PT Cruiser had it available in the early 2000s.
That was still Dynoc.
It was a version of the same concept. It was a fake wood, and it was some sort of vinyl applique that they put on the vehicle.
Okay.
Wood hasn't completely gone away from cars. This is actually a modern car. This is the frame on a Morgan being built in England. And if you lived in England, you can't legally get this car in the U.S., but if you lived in England, you could buy this car, which is a four-passenger Morgan. There's the actual full car. But it uses a lot of wood still in the, a lot of ash still in the body.
Okay. I wasn't aware they still did. I knew they did it just a few years ago, but they're still doing it.
They have a modern model called the Arrow 8. And it still has the old fenders, but it otherwise the body looks modern. It still uses wood in there. As a matter of fact, they have I think it's a plexiglass piece over the back so you can see the wood from inside the car.
About that.
But it has very little, but it still has some, because that's a Morgan tradition. But as you mentioned about the vinyl fenders and dashboards.
Okay.
Were the
leather.
This is leather, sorry. Okay. To cover the wheels, the interior, to protect the running gear. Sometimes leather. In suspensions, I don't have a really good picture of it because I'm not a good photographer, but I've seen Duesenbergs where they have leather-wrapped springs.
Right, I've seen
just
that.
Just to quiet the springs, and the lacing up the springs are artwork. It's just beautiful. But this is just a patent leather fender.
Yeah, and that's interesting because they just took metal rod and they shaped it as an outline, and if I don't know if you can see it on that one, but you can see the stitching there where they brought it around that metal rod. And
When you see it in person, it kind of looks like metal until you get it really close to it, and then you can see the sheen of the leather. And it's and like you said, the dashboard is a very similar way.
Right.
This is a fabric-covered body for a Bentley.
Yes.
And I was at a car show a number of years ago, and there was a restorer there demonstrating his work, and he had just the ash frame from a Bentley. And as I'm leaning against this unrestored Bentley, I'm realizing I'm leaning against the Bentley, and it has yet to have the vinyl applied. This is the fabric applied to the body, but it has in the corners they'll put aluminum to shape the corners, but otherwise it's mostly open for lightness to the body for racing models. And this is a Wayman-bodied racer.
Right. But didn't they also make them, the whole body would flex easier than metal?
When you mentioned about the wood creaking, on these models, they would creak less because there's nothing to creak against.
Yeah.
It's just the leather wrapped, and it would make it a little quieter.
I've seen some of those Wayman cars. Once in a while, you'll see one, and they're always their high-end cars.
Oh, yes.
And so they always look pretty spectacular, no matter what the body is, you know?
Absolutely, I've always been intrigued by these, just for the use of fabric for the bodywork. And a few years ago, BMW came out with a concept car that was fabric-bodied as well. And this is a 2001 concept car. It looks like it's a matte steel. Or aluminum, but it's actually a fabric body, and you can see here's the car opening, where you can see the engine and the side doors. But when you look at the car from the side view, it just looks like one continuous piece of metal, because the spandex that they used for the bodywork is so smooth. But it's a urethane-covered spandex. And it's interesting to see them still using this kind of idea on a modern car, but it's just a concept at this point.
Well, I guess, you know, they're looking for all sorts of ways to get ahead or just to get people to notice their cars.
Yeah, this was an aerodynamic study, so they could figure out how to curve the body around what otherwise looks like a BMW Z4. But the cars eventually moved into the steel bodies, which is what most of our cars are today. But they've been toying with aluminum for generations. This is a concept car from the 50s from Kaiser Aluminum. And it was one of a number of concepts that they never actually produced, but the idea was there to build an aluminum car. A number of cars have been built this way over the years. Aluminum's been used in a lot of different parts of the cars, but to get a full body on a car took them until the 90s, apparently, when Audi came out with the A8, which was mostly aluminum. Mm-hmm. And the Plymouth Prowler was another.
Okay.
And the aluminum has been more pervasive through the car production to get the weight down. And new aluminums are really strong.
Yeah. Well, now you hear about the Ford pickup truck is aluminum, and
this is a Mercedes here, but being built out of aluminum. And there's the Ford pickup.
And now, you know, they made a big splash with this aluminum body, and now I see commercials, you know, Chevy versus Ford, and you dump a bunch of blocks in the back on which one holds up, but, you know, and I guess they both have their advantages and disadvantages, so.
Yeah, by making the truck out of aluminum, they saved like 800 pounds.
Right.
Wow.
And so when they're trying to get...
it's easier to pull a boat.
It's easier to pull a boat, but they could also put a smaller engine in it. Mm-hmm. And so it's...
I'm wondering why somebody would be pulling a boat during the middle of the mountains. Okay, anyway, sorry.
You're not part of the advertising department. You wouldn't know that. That's how you do it. A number of years ago, I spoke with a few gentlemen who worked on Audi A8 bodywork. Mm-hmm. And they said Audi had designed that car so strong that they had a customer who had been T-boned. Mm. And the car that hit the Audi had to be towed away from the scene, but the Audi drove to the dealership.
Wow.
And...
Wow.
They have come a long way in mm-hmm. you know, tin cans to to this kind of structure here.
So we skipped the picture there.
Yes.
I want to see that one.
That's a Mercedes, lightweight Mercedes body being fabricated out of aluminum. I love the ribbing when they have to mold a body around it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's an art form right there.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Because that's hand formed. Whereas I'm sure that Ford truck is stamped, just stamped metal.
Yes.
But, it's...
Getting it symmetrical and, oh my gosh.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The forms they put down on that are artwork themselves. If mm-hmm. you see a buck without the body on it, an artist really works on that kind of stuff. But this is most likely an SLR from the 50s. Mm-hmm. But then... the other materials that have been used through the years, let me move a couple forward here. This is the Wood Hill Wildfire. You know about that one?
Oh, yeah.
What do you know about that one?
It's, I don't know, it was probably before the Corvette, before the Kaiser Darren.
Yeah.
And back in the early 50s, there's a date on that.
This was taken in 54.
Yeah, I think there was like a minor rage about getting fiberglass body cars. And, you know, we have the Misano car in the museum, and that's all part of this interest people had in. It was like, wow, this new medium of car bodies.
Right, so. Right. Yeah, the Wood Hill Wildfire was one of the first fiberglass cars, mm-hmm. along with the Darren and the Corvette. And as we spoke of the Corvette, this Corvette is still a version of fiberglass for its body. It's more plastic than fiberglass, but it's still a non-metallic body over a metallic chassis. But that helped lighten up vehicles a bit and make them easier to make complex shapes.
Right.
Like the Avanti, the Studebaker Avanti, and other specialty models, low production models of the time. So do you want to talk about your materials
well,
here?
Yeah. Carbon fiber. That's another one. And, you know, you read a lot about carbon fiber in magazines and such. And, you know, I think if you go in a local auto parts store, you see carbon fiber stuff. I'm not sure if it's real carbon fiber. It's probably plastic with the carbon fiber look on the top. But in front of me here, I have real live carbon fiber materials. And I don't know how well you can see this through the plastic cover. And this is about 1 inch thick piece of carbon fiber. There you go. And it's woven material, and where I work, we actually make this stuff. And to weave something like that takes a while. That might take a half hour to weave that chunk of carbon fiber. And that's all it is. This is just fiber, very complex in what they do to it. Now, after they have this, then they put a resin in, and the resin stiffens everything up, the carbon fiber actually is the strength, and they make all sorts of things. They actually will take this. We sell blocks of this, larger pieces and thicker actually, and we sell it to certain high-end car manufacturers, and they machine it. They actually machine it just like you do metal, and they use it in high-strength areas like Formula One race teams, for instance, use that. So that's pretty neat. Now this piece here, this is only, this is a sheet. This is just a cloth sheet of carbon fiber. And if you could focus in on that again, and you can see this. And I'm keeping these in the plastic because this stuff is just as bad as fiberglass. It itches like crazy. And at work, I'll go into the room where they're doing this, and I can spend 10 minutes in there not touching anything. I come out and I can be itching. So, oh yeah, there's fibers are just floating around. We also have other complex parts that we make. You'll have two parts and they kind of are separate, and then you sort of glue them together, and it makes a very high strength. The aerospace industry gets it. Anyway, to get back with the car thing, which is about the show here, a lot of this carbon fiber, people think of it as strength. It also brings you thermal protection. So that's pretty neat. I wasn't aware of the thermal protection. That's the aerospace industry is using some of that for like re-entry into the atmosphere is carbon fiber. High cost of carbon fiber, yes, very high cost, but the strength to weight ratio makes it more economical there. And I came up with this, and Sam, you probably already knew this, but first car, 1971 Citroen SM, had optional lightweight carbon fiber wheels. That I didn't know. 71. Yeah. So that was pretty cool. And in 1996, the McLaren F1 car had the first carbon fiber body shell. And I was thinking of having pictures of that, but I didn't bring them in. Until recently, material has been limited use in mass-produced cars because of the expense, the materials, the equipment. There's also skilled labor involved there. And but now things are becoming more and more more popular, I guess I could say, mainstream. So still high-end cars, you know, you can get some stuff. I don't know, do you know of cars offhand?
Yeah, that regular, if you pull up the slides here, I'll show you.
Yeah.
It's, this is actually the weaving of the carbon fiber. So you can see the fine threads.
Mm-hmm.
You said you thought this was more of a cylinder.
A tube, we'll say.
And then this is a frame from an Alfa Romeo.
Okay.
And you can see the carbon fiber insert in the middle of the aluminum frame. The Alfa Romeo 4C is a high-end model. It's a four-cylinder sports car that costs about $70,000. So, as you said, it's on the expensive side to make carbon fiber. But the price is coming down. This is the bodywork off of a BMW i3, which is an electric car that costs around $40,000.
Yeah, and it just shows, I mean, I don't know. I'm thinking those guys might be pretty strong, but still, still. To do that, yeah.
Oh, it's, yeah. It's a lightweight thing. Here's the BMW itself,
yeah.
And BMW has been working really hard to bring down the cost.
So it almost looks like your car.
It's not orange enough.
Oh. Okay.
They make orange carbon fiber.
I think all I've ever seen is black, but
carbon's usually black.
We can work that. Yeah. Orange carbon.
Yeah, oh, there you go.
That's your next invention.
That's next.
Okay. Yeah.
The i3 and the i8 are electric and electric hybrid models that use a lot of carbon fiber. So BMW has contracted. They are investing in a company in Washington State that is going to be the largest carbon fiber plant in the world.
Okay.
And they're bringing down the cost of carbon fiber, so it's moving into more and more of their models. Mm-hmm. It's BMW is advertising in the i3 and the i8. I've seen ads for the carbon core on the new 7 Series, and parts are getting less and less expensive. Didn't you mention the Toyota?
Yeah. I mean, that Toyota there.
Yes.
Okay. Actually, that's not a carbon fiber thing we're looking for, but you know, the manufacturers are always looking to save weight. And, you know, I'm sure the EPA wants the manufacturers to save weight, because, you know, then you're using less fuel and so on and so forth. But that car there is a Toyota 86 GRMN. It's a sports car. It's only in Japan, though, so you can't have it.
Oh,
I don't think
too bad.
Your family couldn't fit in there.
No.
I think
the back seat's small, but
back seat, yeah.
So a tiny one.
So anyway,
spoiler.
That car there, the back window is 50% lighter than most back windows, or back light. Mm-hmm. There we go. It's made out of a polycarbonate, which is a type of plastic, and it's made by a company out of Saudi Arabia. That's a third largest producer of that kind of stuff. Pretty interesting stuff. So that's a Toyota window, and the headline and article I saw, loses 50% of the weight with this material. And I just think that's, you know, just one of the ways they're saving. You know, most of the stuff Sam and I have talked about is body stuff. But, you know, with the carbon fiber, we kind of got into the car now. And, you know, here it is, the back light or the back window of this car is really a high strength plastic.
And glass gets heavy. And the new Ford GT has Gorilla Glass for its windshield.
Gorilla Glass.
As in,
yes,
your cell phone. And so it's really strong and really light.
And I had something, okay, polycarbonate, which is the... That material, that back window there, is 250 times the impact resistance, but only half the weight of regular glass.
Wow.
So that's impressive. Absolutely. That is really impressive. Especially a year ago, I had to put a new window in my car. But that's, now if I had polycarbonate, yeah. I even bought it in here, I think.
Yeah.
Okay. So anyway, so that's like reinforced windows and stuff. It's a type of plastic. There's other kinds of plastic they're using. I have a carbon fiber reinforced ABS, which is a type of plastic again, and it's making the chassis of a 3D printed automobile. And, you know, I don't know if you viewers out there are familiar with this 3D printing. It's taken engineering by storm, and now they're producing cars out of
A couple years ago at the Detroit Auto Show, we were at a stand, and there was this loud noise, and we're at the press day, so there were only like a few thousand people there instead of the crowds, the whole thing. But you can hear this loud noise just going through the whole room, and what is that noise? Well, it's the 3D printer. Mm-hmm. They were 3D printing a car, and it was they had a whole shop set up there. Local Motors is a company in California that is making 3D printed cars. And it takes a couple days to get the whole chassis built, but it only takes a few hours to assemble it after you're done with it.
Right.
But it's an all plastic chassis.
Yeah.
Huh. Good.
So anyway, that's kind of the story about the carbon stuff, the plastic, and there's still other things. that are getting produced. And did you have any other, did you have plastic stuff you were going to talk about?
The 3D printing was the one I really wanted
okay.
to get into there.
Okay, and I'm looking at that, and you can mention that.
Yeah, if you'll bring the picture up, this is a picture I took at the car show in Detroit of the 3D printer. And it prints at a very thin layer, so it takes a long time to build up an entire car. This year, somebody had Infiniti had a small 3D printer building a scale model of a car, and that took 8 hours.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wow. So this is a full chassis.
What's interesting about that? I did not see these pictures before we went on the air, but you see that Sabic printed on the side of that wall there. That's the company that is making these polycarbonate windows in the back of the Toyota. And I just thought that was interesting. I didn't even hear this company until 2 days ago. There it is. Okay. So, interesting stuff. Another plastic thing, if you can go back to the previous picture, I believe it is. Yeah. This is another little Japanese car, a Daihatsu Copen convertible. That's a division of Toyota. Again, they are not sold here in the U.S. All the cool stuff isn't over here. This is interesting. You can get 3D printed Effect Skins. That's their brand name, Effect Skins. It's small exterior bumper and fender panels in different colors and textures. 15 intricate and geometric patterns in 10 different colors. So you can kind of customize your own little car.
Accessorize it. Yeah.
So I'm almost thinking the black portions of that vehicle is what you can change to get different textures. And I didn't see any pictures of them. It just had, you know, just the regular stuff there. And that it's 3D printed and it's thermoplastic. And so I guess it's sort of flexible, like you see the plastic on the front and rear of car now, like where the bumpers are. So that was kind of interesting. And select markets this year, commercialization in 2017. So it makes you think maybe that idea will be in the U.S. in next year. I don't know.
I think the idea is that you can go to your dealer and say, I need this, and they'll print it right there. They don't have to keep them in stock.
Yeah.
So they can actually just make the thing right there, and you can have your car personalized right on the spot with exactly what you want.
Except, again, it's that 3D printing. It might be a wait of a few hours. But
better than shipping it in.
Yeah, from Japan. Okay. Yeah. Now, I came across some other materials that reduce weight in automobiles, and one of them is magnesium. And I have a quote here from an article I read. It says, the rear view mirror used in passenger cars, for example, was once heavy enough to pound a nail. Okay, I don't know what size nail. Today, most rear view mirrors are made of a magnesium frame and a plastic shell, yet retain the same strength and functionality as their corpulent predecessors. So in other words,
you can still pound a nail in with it?
Well, I guess so. But, you know, we're just talking, you know, little thing hanging there. But that's what they're doing. Maybe you're not going to cut, one piece that weighs 300 pounds and next year is going to weigh 150. But, you know, they're shaving off a few pounds here, a few pounds here, and it all adds up. I'm a race fan, and I know that's what they do with race cars. Everywhere, you know, they'll shave the head of a bolt if they lose, you know, a fraction of an ounce.
So when they made the lightweight Mazda RX-7 20 years ago, they drilled holes in the brake in the gas pedal
to get
a little more weight out of it.
A little bit, but it adds up. So anyway, magnesium is the lightest of all structural materials, highest strength to weight ratio. Compared to aluminum, we were talking about aluminum before, it's more expensive per pound, but it's 33% lighter in weight and comparable in strength. So, you know, we got some good stuff coming out. You can machine it easy. Now, this is interesting because I always thought magnesium came from a hole in the ground. A lot of it does, but 60% of the magnesium is extracted from seawater. And I found some interesting things, and I had to kind of put this more in my my level of thinking here. But out of a cubic mile of seawater, you can have 6 million tons of magnesium. Just think about that. That's a lot. I mean, cubic mile of water is a lot, too.
But still,
6 million tons. That's a lot of titanium. Enough magnesium in the Earth's oceans to supply all of our magnesium needs for the next 1,000 years. That just astounded me, you know. It's like, and it's out there. A lot of stuff out there. So anyway, they have a way they can take it out of seawater, electrolytic. I think I said that right. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the way they do sea salt. I think that's how they do that too. But that's magnesium. That was kind of interesting. And now somebody said about magnesium, you get a magnesium fire, basically you can't put it out. Yeah. But they have certain things, and I saw this, and I didn't put it in my notes, but there's a certain way, you know, they can make it so it's not going to burn, and they're talking certain ways they can weld the stuff, and so on and so forth. You think of welding as a lot of high heat things. But so anyway, that's magnesium. Also, there was titanium. And, you know, this is stuff, you know, 40 years ago, they weren't thinking of this stuff, or 50 or 60 years ago. And, you know, as Sam said, you go back 100 years ago with the cars, and you got the wood frame, you got metal, sheet metal tacked onto it. And, you know, then we progress where it's just stamped metal, and it's been that way for decades. And they're constantly re-engineering this stuff, and technology is always moving on and on and on. So they're searching everything to kind of get, I don't know, just to get ahead of their competitors or get ahead of EPA, who can crack down on that, and they're always extending the fuel mileage thing. I think in 5 years or 10 years, they want the fuel mileage average over 50 miles a gallon now.
That's a whole other discussion. Mm.
Yeah, but still, you know, that's what they're moving towards, and whether or not they're going to get it or what happens, you know.
No, so that's the aluminum in the trucks. That's the titanium in cars. That's magnesium in cars. Yeah. That's all these things. They're trying to find any way to
increase your gas mileage,
make the car stronger, make the car lighter.
Mm-hmm.
You know, from the glass to I've seen titanium in engine parts, magnesium in wheels, anything to lighten up the cars.
So let me throw out a few titanium things here. Lightweight, corrosion resistant, perfect. Okay, light or weight reductions as much as 60% per component. Now I don't know what they exactly mean by that, but I'm thinking, okay, you got a hunk of metal, 100 pounds, and whatever it is, you're basically replacing with titanium, so you're saving.
If you had a steel, yeah, you're saving 60 pounds, it'd be 100 pounds, it'd be 40 pounds.
Yeah, that's but anyway, titanium alloys cost a lot. But Pacific Northwest National Laboratory in Washington State, I had to look this place up, has developed a low-cost titanium alloy. Pacific Northwest, which is PNNL, is a department of, it's a laboratory for the Department of Energy. So, you know, they're trying to get stuff too. So what they have now is an alloy. It's the strongest alloy made to date. It's 10 to 15% stronger than previous versions of a titanium alloy. Now, it was originally produced 50 years ago. And this is interesting. Again, this is modern technology talk. 50 years ago, they produced it, but it was not suited for volume production, and it also presented defects. Now it's made with a different process. It costs $3 a pound instead of $90 a pound. Now, the way they found out that it wasn't working and they came up with this new way of making it and stuff is modern visualization techniques. They have electron microscopy and atom probe tomography. Okay, so that's this new technology. They're getting down the molecular end of things. Still more expensive to steel, but the weight to cost and the strength to cost and all that stuff makes it more affordable. So you have these stronger materials, means you have to use less and makes everything lighter all around, and it's kind of neat. And you know, I'm an old car person, but you can't help but be interested in this new technology coming down the road. And, you know, what we're talking about today, 5 years from now, you know, it's like, who knows what they'll have, you know? So.
Now, when you look at how cars got so heavy over into the 50s and 60s, into the 70s, and then we've just tried to find ways to bring down the weight by adding aluminum and first downsizing, then adding aluminum, and then the lighter weight glasses and the things like that. One thing I didn't bring up was that when they were developing the Corvette two generations ago, I think it was, they were looking for a way to make it quieter. And the way they did that was putting in the floorboards balsa wood.
I've heard about that.
So they actually laid balsa wood in the floor. Lexus quieted their cars down with asphalt in the door panel, inside the body panels, so that it would quiet them down. Yeah. And they're looking for everything, you know, from the titanium to the carbon fiber to asphalt in your doors.
And it's interesting, you know, we're talking about cars, but I always have a feeling that, you know, whatever I have a problem with today, no matter what the product is, like the next time I go to buy one, it's going to be improved, and they're always improving things.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, whether it's dish detergent or it's cars. I do wash dishes once in a while. Okay. So that's it.
Okay.
That's it. Thanks, Sam.
Yeah, thanks.
Great. Thank you for all the photos and the visual aids.
Visual aids,
yeah. Very helpful. Thanks
to Bally Ribbon Mills, where I work, for supplying this stuff.
Yes,
here.
Thank you.
And Kurt Wilkerson, I said I would thank you, so there it is. Thanks, Kurt. He's an engineer with this stuff.
Very cool. The future.
Yep.
The future is now.
The future is now.
That's right. I guess, oh boy, we have time for some car quiz tonight.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so the number again here in the studio is 610-378-0426. And we've got our first car up there.
Let's see, what can I say about this car? I sold one of these brand new when I was a kid in Grand Central Terminal in New York City, the train station. I know that's not really a hint or a clue or anything, but I remember seeing
really
one.
Really narrow it down, no.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It was red, if I remember right.
Okay. So this company also made red cars. That's
yes.
Yeah. Well, here's a clue. They also had a brand new Oldsmobile Toronado, and it was the first year for the Toronado. So there you go. So
I was always intrigued by the styling of the front and the taillights on this car.
Yeah, the taillights, because they were sequential.
Right.
And I remember seeing TV commercials, and they show, you know, you turn left and the lights go bing, 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 you know, right to left or whatever.
What other car used the taillights from this car?
I am going to say I don't know.
How about the Shelby Mustang?
You know, I was thinking that, because then I was thinking,
they took the grill work off of it, but it's the same taillight.
Yeah, okay. Because I was thinking the California Special used the Shelby type of thing, I don't know. Okay, let's see. Interesting options on this car. The Oxford roof, which is shown, $84.25 for that.
Is that just Oxford white, or is that a vinyl top?
It's a vinyl top, okay. But that was their name, was Oxford Roof.
Oxford,
it made it sound
roof.
English, I guess.
Sounds right? Very sophisticated.
Very sophisticated. Well, this was kind of a sophisticated car. AM radio with stereosonic tape system. Cost you $188.50.
Gosh, that's today, too.
Okay. Remember those tape systems? Camera person. Okay, styled steel wheels, which this has, they would cost you $115.15 for all four of them, of course. So, let's see. This particular model is introduced mid-year. And it had a fancier interior, wood grain dashboard. And the transmission, which was optional, was called a Merc-O-Matic, which is another hint. Yes, we have a home viewer. What are we looking at there, sir?
that a 67 Mercury Cougar?
Well, almost. What kind of 67 Mercury Cougar?
What kind?
Yeah. Besides one with an Oxford roof.
Man, you're tough, Dan.
Yeah, he is tough.
This is the special mid-year model. It was the XR7, which is a little sportier and a little nicer car.
Okay.
So how did you know this was 67? Is that your car, by the way?
No, it's not my car.
Okay.
I could tell by the vent windows in the side, it would be 67. It was the last year for those.
Okay. Okay, Sam mentioned about the front end and then the taillights, and I always thought that the headlights were kind of neat too, the way they, you know, you turn them on and spin around and that kind of thing.
Yes, so. It is a neat car.
Oh yeah, and if you look close, there's a whole bunch of them in that picture, yeah. But I just focused in on that one. So, okay, well, thanks for calling.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
And these cars also, before we go on to the next one, had the standard engine of 289, which is substantial engine for a kind of lightweight car, 200 horsepower, which is okay. But you could also get a 225 horsepower, same size engine, or 390 cubic inch engine running at 320 horsepower. So that would get moving, I guess.
Yeah.
So
this car is slightly related to the Mustang.
Oh yeah, it's slightly related. I have a quote here, basically a dressed up Mustang. So I think they use same chassis and a bunch of other stuff. Okay, next picture.
Oh. So we go from high end to low end?
I love it.
Pretty much, yeah, yeah. And I think that picture was taken about a mile from here. I think that was the AACA show here in Reading.
Oh, wow.
But that doesn't help.
That's Vanity Fair back there.
No, it's not enough Vanity. It's
okay, so it doesn't even have four-wheel covers.
No.
Oh, it's fabulous.
It's a fabuloso car.
I love it.
My neighbor had one of these, too. Same color when I was a little kid. Again, that doesn't help anybody. The Fox, they lived across the street.
I hope you're watching.
How about a clue of this being our second orphan brand?
This is an orphan brand. Yes, we have a home viewer. What are we looking at there?
I'd say that's about a maybe 50, either Plymouth or a Dodge. And if it's a Dodge, it might be a Wayfarer.
Okay.
Or a Plymouth, it might be a Savoy or a Plaza or something.
Now, do you think that's a cool-looking car or sort of plain Jane? You could show the next picture, too, Sam. There's the back of it.
Yeah. Years ago, I had on the other side where the gas cap is, if it's sticking out, it's a 49. If it's in it, I'd say it's a 50. You made it 51.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
So, and you said, go ahead.
I had years ago a 49 Dodge Wayfarer. It was a flathead.
Oh, all right.
With a fluid drive in.
Yep.
Very nice car.
Okay.
Okay, yeah, have a great show, Dan.
All right. Hey, thanks for calling.
Thank you.
That caller had it right. It is a 1950 Plymouth. He wasn't sure if it was Plymouth or Dodge. It's called Plymouth Suburban. It's a model P19 six-passenger coupe. And that was the inexpensive one. I believe it was a 100-inch wheelbase. It was a small Plymouth. And he mentioned a Dodge Wayfarer. Well, Plymouth made the same type of car. It was a roadster. It's only set to, I guess, three people. They had this coupe, and then they had the regular coupe with a trunk on it. And they were probably the least expensive Plymouths or Dodgers you could buy back then in their 49 through maybe 53. So somebody, I have a quote here that I got tonight, and it says, the company heavily promoted the fact that the rear fenders on all its products were attached with bolts and readily replaceable in case of collision damage. We were talking earlier about the aluminum pickup truck versus a steel pickup truck, and no matter what you come with, there's going to be people. Well, back then, I know Ford, in 1950, they didn't have removable removable fenders, and that was a new way. So Plymouth, with their old style, they're saying, yeah, but you can still take our fenders off. And it was kind of interesting when I read that. So
find a selling point for anything. Pardon? Find a sell a good selling point.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, anything.
Oh, ours come off.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, this is a 1950 Plymouth Suburban. Another clue, I was going to say it has a Mayflower hood ornament. And you can zoom in on the other picture maybe. But you see kind of a stylized ship there. Cost you $1,840 there. And 97 horsepower engine. So it wasn't real powerful. And at that time, the Plymouth was third largest automaker in U.S. at only 15% of the market share.
Well,
I think Chevy
changed.
Was like 50% or something. They were way up there.
I just wrote an article about the low-cost Ford in 1939. And Chevy, Ford, and Plymouth made up like 75% of the, like 60 to 70% of the market.
Wow.
Just those three brands.
And I'm supposed to guess what the...
What was the fourth?
The fourth. I'm going to say Essex?
No, not in 39.
Oh, 39. Studebaker.
Yeah. Studebaker.
Okay.
Studebaker introduced their low-end champion in 39.
Okay. Now, I was all ready to say the next car, but Sam, I think you got a couple for me, right?
Yes. I'm going to have to toggle through a few of your choices here.
Okay. For later.
Yeah, yeah,
these will be the future. Here's one for you.
Okay.
This is from a brochure that I have for a car that was proposed for the U.S. market.
Oh, proposed.
The brochure was American brochure, but the car was never actually sold in the U.S.
Okay. Was it made by a U.S. company, U.S.-based company?
It was not made by a U.S.-based company.
I don't like how he said that.
you picked that up.
There's something else going on there.
Oh, boy. And, you know, it looks too long to be a European style car too. It looks
the proportions are odd because it has a short wheelbase, but the car is kind of
a lot
short.
Of overhang. So,
but it's got a lot of overhang. The engine's out back. As you can see here, it's a V6.
You just threw me. I'm going to say like a European Ford.
It's actually a European Renault.
It's a
Renault Alpine.
Okay.
And this was Renault's sports car. From the 60s until the mid-80s.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And in 85 or 86, Renault was going to bring it in when they owned AMC.
Okay, yep.
And they put out brochures. They put together the whole package on bringing this to the States. As a matter of fact, the American version has exposed headlights, has hidden headlights, whereas the European one had flush headlights because the European-style headlights weren't legal in the States when they came out with this. Mm-hmm. And... this car was put on the back burner when Chrysler bought AMC.
Okay.
So Chrysler had a model that was going to be in the same price range. This was put on the back burner.
Okay. And there's another one.
There's another one.
That's a Moskvich.
Close. Right country.
Yeah, I mean, where I saw that car was probably the same place you took it.
Yeah, this was at Radnor last year.
Yeah. Moskva?
No.
I forget.
It's a Volga.
Volga.
Yes.
Okay.
It's a Volga, the Gaz 21. Yeah. And the owner told me how the two-tone paint was an option on this car, but because Russians were poor, not many people optioned up for it. So when this car was restored, it was restored with the two-tone paint.
Yeah.
And it was...
I talked quite a bit with that guy.
He was very interesting.
Yeah, very, very. So.
Yeah, he brought this car in. He was Russian. And he brought this car in and then had it all restored. There was something about having to take it back to the factory before it could leave the country, before it could be restored or something like that. And it's in beautiful condition for a 60-year-old Russian car.
Yeah, it is.
Does he lives here in the United States?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, but he kind of goes back and forth. I forget exactly how his business went, but he's working between the two countries.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
But it lives like in Brooklyn or something like that.
A lot of people think it's a Ford or it's, you know, maybe a European Ford or something like that. But
that
it's
neat.
Yeah. So
I missed the wrong year of Radnor.
Yeah.
Man, that thing's neat.
So you're coming this weekend, right?
I'm not, actually. Okay. I have a wedding to go to. But you two will be there.
Yes.
And we should mention that there's a Concours in Radnor this Sunday, and the museum will be represented there.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a really neat So it's a great setting. A
couple hundred cars will be there. Yeah. Some of the nicest Concours cars you'll see outside of the really big shows.
They're beautiful. I was there a few years ago, and it was really neat. And they do the thing with all the fancy carriages, and they the get all dressed up, you know, in their regalia, and it's mm-hmm. it's really cool. It's
carriages will be on display at 10:30. Mm-hmm. Car shows from 9 until 3.
Yeah, neat show. So mm-hmm. if you're interested, check that out. Radnor, the Radnor Hunt Concours d'Elegance. So it's time for us to wrap up for this month. And thank you, Dan and Sam. I had the easiest job in the world tonight. I just listened. It was all interesting.
I saw you over there taking notes.
I was taking my notes.
Unless there was something to do with...
No, it was all about what you guys were talking about.
Oh, okay. Just checking on you.
It was not my grocery list or something like that. So until October, be safe, and we'll see you in the fall.
Along the Road on BCTV is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles,